grace to offer our thanks to God with all our hearts. We gather with this community of faith
to follow Jesus, who longs to lead us into life.
We gather in these moments
to learn all we can of grace from the Holy Spirit.
We continue together with the prayer of the day. You pull on your work boots, crafted from love. You hang justice and peace on your tool belt. You take on rebuilding neighborhoods when we would walk away. What have you to do with us, Holy God?
You model compassion for us.
You take us by the hand to lift us to our feet. You show us the path which leads to humility. You leave a trail of grace crumbs so that we might follow. What have you to do with us, brother of the poor?
You call us to serve by your side.
You plant words of peace deep into our hearts. You raise up little children to whisper hope to us. You stand by the side of all who look for life. What have you to do with us, Spirit of Grace?
You teach us how to build up others with love.
What have you to do with us, God in community, holy in one?
Everything, it turns out, and everything, as we lift our prayer to you.
Teach us to sing, Lord, each person. going over a song that we're going to sing in a little while. It is week 6, and our theme this week is kindness. Kindness might be the most important thing in the whole world. When we receive kindness, we feel good, hopeful, important, and we feel connected to the world. When we give kindness, we feel good, hopeful, important, and connected to the world. Here are a few examples of kindnesses that I experienced yesterday. My next door neighbor, gave me 2 onions from his garden, and I love onions. I helped my neighbor move his chicken house. My wife scratched my back at the end of the day, and I was sore, and it felt so good. When I went to the gas station, all of us were wearing masks to protect each other. When I went to the pharmacy yesterday, I saw that my pharmacists were both pretty stressed, and I just took a minute and told them how much I appreciate their work. Giving and receiving kindness helps us feel good, hopeful, important, and connected to the whole world. There is a word for this generous way. It's called shalom. Shalom is a Hebrew word, and a lot of the time it's translated into English as peace or prosperity. Shalom means you and I are connected. And so that I know your peace and prosperity is important for my peace and prosperity. Or as my friend Marva says, shalom means if there's anything I have that you need, it's yours. Kindness might be the most important thing in the world. You better believe there's a bunch of stuff in the Bible about kindness. For Bible time today, we're going to be looking at a passage in Ephesians. Ephesians 4, verse 32. I want to teach it to you. It's really short. So, here's how we'll learn it together. I'll speak the lines, and you echo them after me. Okay? It starts this way. Be kind to one another.
Be kind to one another.
Tender-hearted and forgiving.
Tender-hearted and forgiving.
Even as God in Christ has done for you.
Even as God in Christ has done for you.
All right, so let's break this down a little bit. That first line, be kind to one another. Well, that sounds pretty simple, right? Be kind to one another. I think of kindness as sharing goodness. And it says do that to whom? Just your cat. No, just to the people you really love. Probably those things, but it says to one another, like whoever's around you, which could mean your family, it could mean your best friends, and also your neighbors that you'll meet on the sidewalk or in the park, and also the people that you don't even know, but that you will run across today. Be kind to one another. The second line is tender-hearted and forgiving. What does tender-hearted look like? I think of tender-hearted as being open, as being generous, as saying yes to who people are, even if you don't agree with them. Tender-hearted. And forgiving, well, forgiving, maybe sometimes that means helping someone find their way after they've made a mistake. This can be a huge challenge, because sometimes to forgive someone, we have to think about how we may have been hurt by that person. And the last part, even as God in Christ has done for you. Well, what does that mean? Well, the first parts are be kind to one another, tender-hearted, and forgiving. It sort of means because that's how God has been with you. So this passage is from part of the Bible called the New Testament. It's the part with Jesus in it. And it's a letter from the Apostle Paul to his church. Also in the New Testament are the Gospels, which are the stories about Jesus. And in those Gospels, we see Jesus being kind a lot of the time. There are stories of Jesus healing people that have viruses or infections. We see Jesus giving food to people who don't have enough to eat. We see Jesus visiting people who have no friends. And we see Jesus forgiving people who feel really bad about the things that they have done. And all those wonderful stories about Jesus being open-hearted and generous, tender-hearted, forgiving, being kind, that's a good model of what our lives can be like. Music time today. I've actually got a little song that I remember learning, I think when I was in fifth grade or something. That was back the last century. It's called Be Ye Kind, and it recites this verse that we just had, except the language is a little bit different. I'll sing it for you so you know how it sounds, and then we'll do it three times through. Be ye kind, one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God, for Christ's sake, has forgiven you. Do-do, doodly-do, Ephesians 4:32.
Scripture today is from Ephesians 4, verses 1 through 16 and 25 through 32. I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. But each of us was given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore it is said, when he ascended on high, he made captivity itself a captive. He gave gifts to his people. When it says he ascended, what does it mean but that he also descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is the same one who ascended far above all the heavens, so that he might fill all things. The gifts he gave were that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, some teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until all of us come to the unity of faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity, to the measure of the knowledge, to the measure of the full stature of Christ, We must no longer be children tossed to and fro and blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness in deceitful scheming, but speaking the truth in love. We must grow up in every way into Him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knitted together by every ligament with which it is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth in building itself up in love. So then, putting away falsehood, let all of us speak the truth to our neighbors, for we are members of one another. Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger. Do not make room for the devil. Thieves must give up stealing rather than let them labor and work honestly with their own hands, so as to have something to share with the needy. Let no evil talk come out of your mouths, but only what is useful for building up as there is need, so that your words may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with which you were marked with a seal for the day of redemption. Put away from all your bitterness and wrath, and anger and wrangling and slander, together with all malice, and be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ has forgiven you.
I was thinking this week about the phrase, which came first, the chicken or the egg? It's a great way to say, in this life, there are just some things that are so interdependent with one another that one without the other would be impossible. And I was thinking about how that works with kindness. Which comes first? Kindness or respect? Kindness or truth? Kindness or integrity? Kindness or love? Because let's just be honest here about kindness. Every one of us has encountered a person or persons to whom we have a great deal of difficulty being kind. They just rub us the wrong way. Perhaps we have seen them be so cruel to someone else that we just don't see how they deserve any kindness from us. Perhaps they have committed unthinkable crimes, even. And we just can't bring ourselves to that place of being civil, let alone kind. And then, on the other hand, if we are at all in touch with our intuitive nature, we know what it is to be on the other side of fake kindness. Though, you know, those moments when somebody is kind to you and we ask ourselves, I wonder what he wants from me that he's being so nice. Or perhaps we have felt that dripping condescension of someone who believes it's a duty to be kind to those who are less than themselves. Truth be told, kindness sounds like an easy thing to do, but it really isn't. Is it kinder to be brutally honest or to build someone up with something that's mostly true? And where is that line when you're making that decision? How long and in what way do we lift someone up who is going through difficult times so that we don't become a codependent crutch, patting ourselves on the back for the support that we're giving, rather than truly a kind friend who encourages and challenges the strength that you know is lying under the surface and just waiting to come out of that person again. Some days it's tough to know what is truly right and true. Some days it feels tough to call ourselves Christian, especially when it has come to mean something very different to some than it does to others. So I want you to hear these words again. We must no longer be children, tossed to and fro, and blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness in deceitful scheming, but speaking the truth in love, we must grow up in every way into Him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knitted together by every ligament with which it is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth in building itself up in love. It really does matter what we believe about Jesus. It really does matter what we believe about God and the divine spirit that blows through this world. It really does matter what we believe about our Holy Scripture, but not so that we can call ourselves the right kind of Christian. Not because someone has told us which doctrine is truly Christian and which is not. It matters what we believe about Jesus, because if we are to grow in every way into Him who is the head, into Christ, we best familiarize ourselves with just who it is that we are growing into. I'll be honest, I think that's why I am drawn into this United Church of Christ. We are a denomination that long ago declared itself to be a covenantal rather than a doctrinal or a creedal church. You see, I've seen doctrines be pulled and twisted. Creeds, doctrines come and go with time and context. Even those doctrines which we claim to have stood the test of time will be challenged eventually. See, if our faith is active and growing, it is only right that our doctrines shift as our understanding evolves. So when those doctrines become the center of our faith, rather than Christ, it's too easy to lose sight of the one who is the head, the one around whom we center our lives, our community, our very being. How do we grow into the kindness of Christ? What is a Jesus sort of kindness? So easy to romanticize Jesus, to paint this picture that is more like a movie caricatured monk figure than like the Jesus that we really meet in Scripture. A Jesus kind of kindness, it seems to me, was not always what we would call nice. In Jesus's kindness, there was challenge. Encouraging a man to walk when he hadn't the courage to try himself. In Jesus' kindness, there was conflict. Standing up against oppressive governments and corrupt religious leaders. No, a Jesus kind of kindness was not always what we would call nice. But it was always honest. In a Jesus kindness, there was integrity. In a Jesus kindness, there was a hand up for everyone who needed it. In a Jesus kindness, there was healing. A Jesus kindness lifted those who had been put down by the society around them. A Jesus kindness brought back to the fold those who had been excluded. A Jesus kindness respected the worth of every human being and was always ready to allow for repentance and transformation. How do we grow into that? How can we be kind? We will be kind, truly kind, only when we realize that there is no kindness without respect, or integrity, or love, or truth. And truth be told, some days we will just need to fake it until we make it. Some days we will need to choose an act of kindness, hoping beyond hope that it will open our hearts to love. And then as we continue to grow into Christ, as we continue to put our lives in God's hands and trust in the Spirit's guidance and follow Jesus' example, perhaps one day our hearts will be fully in tune with the divine. Perhaps one day, having chosen kindness enough times just for the sake of kindness, we will grow fully into Christ's love and Christ's integrity. One day, I believe, Christ's love will dwell so deeply within us that we can choose nothing but kindness. May it be so. Amen.
Does it have feet? Does it stand up?
Would you take a nice deep breath, please? Call upon the Spirit of the risen Christ to surround you as you spend just a moment or two in silent prayer. God of love and justice, we long for peace within and peace without. We long for harmony in our families, for serenity in the midst of struggle, and for commitment to each other's growth. We long for the day when our homes will be a dwelling place for your love. Yet we confess that we are often anxious. We do not trust each other, and we harbor violence. We are not willing to take the risks and make the hard choices that love requires. Look upon us with kindness and grace, loving God. Rule in our homes and in all the world. Show us how to walk in your paths through the mercy of Christ. Hear the longings of our hearts. Hear the depth of our cries, O God, as we speak together the words that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. On this day, once again, we remember that last meal that Jesus shared with his disciples. Knowing what lie ahead of him, he still took time to be with every person, showing kindness even to the one who was about to betray him. And at that sacred meal, he took a simple loaf of bread and he blessed it and he broke it and he gave it to them and said, take and eat. Just as my body will be broken, this bread is broken for you. When they had finished eating, he took a cup and again paused for a blessing. And he gave it to them and said, take and drink. Just as my blood will be poured out, this cup is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. And so we call upon the Spirit of the risen Christ to bless this bread and to bless this cup and to bless each and every one who shares this sacred meal around the world, that we might truly become one in Christ, the body of Christ working here in this world. I invite you to take that piece of bread that you have before you. This is the bread of life. So take and eat. And the cup. Jesus said that this is the cup of the new and the everlasting covenant. So take and drink. Would you join me in prayer, please? You, O Holy One, are blessed.
You, O Holy One, are good.
You, O Holy One, are gracious. You, O Holy One, are always blessing, always birthing, always becoming. All praise and honor and glory are yours. Amen. If you would like to join us, we would love to have you join us for any of our other activities throughout the week, throughout the month. You will find all of those listed and explained on our website, newjourneyunitedchurchofchrist.org. Sorry, newjourneyucc.org. I better give that right. newjourneyucc.org is where you can find out anything you like about our church. And if not, just give us a call if you have the information that you would like. We hope to see you at one of our other events. And so now, I invite you.
Freedom.
take that part of Christ with you as you leave this worship, that you all will know God's love and God's faithfulness. May the peace that surpasses all understanding be with you on this day and always. Amen.